Hi everyone, this is Professor Rood, and this is video 3 of chapter 11 on earthquakes. I want to start today by introducing a couple of different techniques used to measure how large an earthquake is. One scale that we use in determining the size of an earthquake are called intensity scales. That measures the amount of ground shaking at a specific location. And basically what a person does is observe the damage that is done in that area. Magnitude scales are quantitative measurements of ground motion and is based on seismic records. And it measures the amount of energy released at the point of the earthquake. The intensity scale that is used is called the Modified Mercalli Intensity Scale and was developed based on modern California building codes. Developed in 1902, and the purpose of an intensity scale is to observe property destruction in a particular region. And these values of destruction will change based on the distance from the epicenter. The modified Mercalli is a 1 to 12 Roman numeral scale. Let's just take it what a number 5 would encompass. That would be an earthquake that was felt by everyone, many awakened. There could be some disturbances of trees, poles, and other tall objects. Once the earthquake occurs, you map out an area of damage in a specific region. And from that, you can determine the location or the area, general area of where the earthquake occurred. Here I'm going to look at a magnitude 6 earthquake in Central California versus a 5.0 magnitude earthquake in Virginia. What I want you to observe is the number of people reported feeling the earthquake. All right, these are the locations of the people who reported feeling the earthquake. And what you should notice is that in the Northeast and East Coast, the earthquake, although slightly smaller than the California quake, was felt by many more people. Here's the reason why. The rock east of the Rockies is older and colder and behaves in a more rigid fashion, and therefore the seismic waves do not get attenuated. They don't diminish as quickly as if they were traveling through warmer rock, which is the case on the West Coast. An early magnitude scale was the Richter scale, developed by Charles Richter in 1935. And this scale is used to measure the amplitude of the largest seismic wave. This is a logarithmic scale, and that helps to account for decreases in wave amplitude with increased distance. And every step on the magnitude scale indicates a tenfold increase or decrease, depending on which way you're going on the scale, in wave amplitude. So if you go from a 2.0 to a 3.0, that means that the wave amplitude increases 10 times. If you go from a 2 to a 4.0 magnitude, that means that the amplitude of the wave increased 10 times 10, or 100 times greater. Even more impressive is the increase in total energy released on each step of the magnitude scale. So each step, 1 to a 2, is a 32-fold increase in energy release. So a magnitude 1 to a magnitude 2 would indicate 32 times 32 more times more energy, which is 1,024 times more energy. I wanted to point out one correction here that I've made. The largest amplitude waves are usually an S or surface wave. So how can we determine the Richter magnitude of an earthquake? Well, let's follow the steps. Step 1 says measure the height, which is the amplitude of the largest wave on the seismogram. In this example here, the height is measured at 23 millimeters. You plot that on the amplitude scale and the right. So here's 23 plots right there. Step 2, determine the distance to the earthquake using the time interval separating the P and S wave and plot it on the distance scale. In this case, we have the difference at 24 seconds. And then finally, you draw a line connecting the two points and simply read the magnitude from the magnitude scale. So if we connect the S and P time interval with the amplitude, we'll see that this magnitude earthquake was a 5.0. Here we're looking at the change in magnitude of the earthquake versus the ground motion change, that's the amplitude of the waves, versus the energy change. And this is an approximate column here. So if we go from a 1.0 magnitude to a 2.0, actually let's start at 0.5 magnitude to a 1.0, it would be 10 times greater amplitude. If we go from a 0.5 magnitude to a 1.0 magnitude quake, you get 32 times more energy released. Going from a 1 to a 3.0 magnitude increases the amplitude of the wave 1,000 times. So 10 times 10 times 10. And it would be a 32,000 time increase in energy. The original Richter scale developed by Charles Richter in 1935 has been significantly modified due to some limitations. What we now use is called the moment magnitude, and it measures the total energy released during an earthquake. It is measuring or calculating the average amount of slip on the fault, the area of the fault surface that actually moved, and the strength of the faulted rock. This table shows the annual occurrences of earthquakes and their magnitudes. So average per year of greater than a 9.0 magnitude, less than 1. And it gives some examples of previous earthquakes of a certain magnitude and the amount of energy released in kilograms of explosives. So you can see, I'm sorry there, back in 1995, the Kobe, Japan earthquake measured a 6.9. That's considered strong earthquakes, can be destructive in populated areas. Major earthquakes, you're getting up to 7 and 8.8. Great earthquakes are considered 8 to 9. And then the largest ever earthquakes was a magnitude 9.5 in Chile in 1960. How much damage is done to an area depends on how large the earthquake is, and are you close to an area that has a large population of people. As far as destruction from the actual seismic shaking, that depends on the intensity of the earthquake. How long do the vibrations occur is very important. What type of material are the buildings sitting on? And the nature of the building materials, and are there construction practices, codes that are followed when building these structures in an area prone to earthquakes? As far as the construction, the material, this is a wooden structure versus a steel structure. Right next to each other, you can see that the wooden structure did not fare very well compared to this steel structure. If you live in an earthquake-prone area, it is much better to have your structure built on solid bedrock rather than soft sediments. Soft sediments can actually amplify the seismic waves, causing more damage. Liquefaction occurs when there is loosely packed waterlogged sediments, and they behave as a fluid when the ground shakes, and everything will just flow, and whatever's sitting on top of that flowing material goes with it. This is what happens when liquefaction occurs. So these tilted buildings were on unconsolidated sediment, and when the earthquake occurred, they behaved, as I said, like quicksand. Evidence of liquefaction include these features called sand volcanoes. So what happens is you have loose, saturated, sandy material before the earthquake, and when an earthquake occurs, the water and upper sandy layers start to move. The sandy material becomes more tightly packed after the earthquake then. So the pore space is essentially reduced. I'm going to stop at liquefaction today, and I will continue discussing the dangers of earthquakes on video 4 for chapter 11. See you then.